All right, we're going to go ahead and get started with our final panel for today, the opening day. So welcome everyone to the panel discussion on collaborations to advance violence research, policy, and practice. I feel like I'm peeking around here, but also I'll stand up for just a second. My name is Michelle Monroe Kramer, and I'm an assistant professor and the director of global programs at the University of Michigan School of Nursing. And I'm also a board member and part of the planning committee here. And we are excited to have an event where we talk about violence research, practice, and policy, specifically as it relates to NNVAWI. So this is kind of our history lesson related to NNVAWI. And we're really focusing on the past and present today. And then on Thursday, our panel discussion will focus a bit more on the future. So where do we see the future of NNVAWI and violence against research? Violence against women research going. So I'm really excited to be moderating this panel and to having this discussion. I think these are a lot of my sheroes for violence research, and we have some really excellent questions. The plan is to have about 10 minutes from each presenter, and then at the end we will open it up from general questions for the audience. So I'm gonna go ahead and sit down and we'll give you So our first presenter is Jackie Campbell, who is a national leader in research and advocacy in the field of domestic and intimate partner violence. She has authored or co-authored more than 300 publications and 7 books on violence and health outcomes. She is proud of how nursing has been one of the most important disciplines in adding to the research and practice knowledge base about IPV and health outcomes. She is also proud of the accomplishments of those she has mentored in the field. Her expertise is frequently sought by national and international policymakers in exploring IPV and its health effects, including intimate partner homicide on families and communities. Dr. Campbell was also one of the founding members of the Nursing Network on Violence Against Women International. And so we're going to ask her to tell us a little bit about the history of NNVAWI, what was happening in the nursing practice and research world with regards to violence against women when the idea to form this network was conceived.
Well, fortunately, Dr. Bullock is next to me to, you know, when I get stuff wrong, because I'll probably get it wrong. But anyway, it's just so wonderful to be here, first of all. And the Nursing Network on Violence Against Women International, and I always think of it as herstory, going back to those feminist roots. We were talking, Marilyn, about that class I taught at Wayne when we all learned about feminist pedagogy together, because I was teaching supposedly, but not really knowing much more than my students. But when NNVAWI started, back in 1985 was the first conference. I was a PhD student. So those of you that are PhD students or just got your PhD, you know, this is absolutely where you should be. And there were 7 of us at that point that it was at a time, 1985, first of all, you know, violence against women was sort of part of the feminist movement. The second wave of feminism was to point out that women were being battered, is what oftentimes was talked about at that point. And that it had nothing to do with nursing, as far as anybody could tell. That it was a totally, you know, we were oftentimes accused of medicalizing the problem if we talked about health outcomes, et cetera. So Chris King was the actual person that said, you know, we need to, she was a real rabble rouser, and she said, you know, we need to have a conference of nurses to address this issue. And it was the first VAWA Act, I'm going to probably get this wrong, it was 1993, anybody know? Four. Well, at least it was within a decade. Pretty good. 1994. So it was pre-VAWA, was pre the government thinking much about these issues. Definitely a feminist grassroots issue around violence against women. And Chris said, nurses need to be a part of this. Well, I had done a study, my first study of homicide of women was published in 1981. So many of us that were in nursing doing this got together through various ways. That was pre-internet. So Dan Sheridan, who was our male founder, put an ad in the American Journal of Nursing. Are there any other nurses besides me that care about domestic violence? Something like that. I responded, hey, I'm out here. So we were all around the country, and so that's how many of us got to know each other. And then Chris had this conference, and per usual, on a shoestring, typically, you know, begging funds from wherever you were employed, your university. And the organization was not, terribly sophisticated, to say the least. But Chris pulled it off, and we had a pretty good audience. And Ann Burgess gave the keynote address at that conference. Now, the next year, when I'd gotten that PhD, I gave the keynote address. And I'll never forget some of our male colleagues that were in the field. Several of them heard that I actually cried while giving that address, and how tacky was that? You know, a typical female response. And our friends, the physicians, they were very patronizing about the whole thing with nurses being involved. But we carried on, by George. And what the thing that I am incredibly proud of is the science that nursing scholars and their collaborators, because there are many of you here that are not nurses, but our collaborators, the science we have added to the field that has been incredibly important. Many of the breakthroughs have been as a result of nursing research or nurses collaborating with other researchers in the field. So is that okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So to add on, we're going to have Linda Bullock speak next. Linda is an adjunct professor and professor emerita at the Sinclair School of Nursing, University of Missouri, and at the University of Virginia School of Nursing. Her research has focused on domestic violence in a population of pregnant women, and has included collaborating with nurses nationally and internationally and with members of other disciplines on the University of Missouri and University of Virginia campuses. Specifically, she has investigated the prevalence of intimate partner violence, its consequences to mother and fetus, and intervention strategies to improve health outcomes in both women and children. The research not only addresses a gap in knowledge, but is also providing evidence-based practice recommendations for clinical practice. It has been useful in advising legislators and policymakers in their development of programs to aid these populations. And so our question for you, Linda, is what difference has NNVAWI made to knowledge building in the domestic violence field, particularly nursing practice and nursing education?
So okay. Will you talk about Doris? Since I forgot. I forgot, and I apologize, but Doris Campbell, one of my best friends ever, and who has now passed along, was one of the founding members of NNVAWI, and she, her daughters have funded the scholarship that brought, I know, two of you here, so, and that will continue to do. All right.
Sorry.
Good. Yes, I was just a master's student when Jackie gave that keynote speech in 1986 in Amherst, Massachusetts. And what you forgot to say is that we all stayed in dorms. Do you remember?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Chris and Joe arranged that, you know, we could all stay in the University of Massachusetts Amherst dorms. And you said something about the shoestring. I think in NVWS still runs on a shoestring, doesn't it? Yeah. But this conference is so important. And so Michelle asked me to speak how it's impacted my own research. And I can tell you that in 1990 or 1991, someone here can correct me what year that was, the meeting was down in Florida. At that time, I was living in New Zealand. And I've got to say that for all my foreign friends that are out there, I put the I in NNVAWI because I came home from New Zealand to go to the conference. I was at that time then a PhD student in New Zealand, and it was at the conference that I met Dr. Marianne Curry, who was doing a lot of research. She's a woman's health nurse practitioner, labor delivery, and she had just published on her tool called the prenatal psychosocial profile. And I was just saying that, you know, I wanted to measure that social support and stress in these pregnant women that we've been hearing about that has impacted pregnant, I mean, at this point, I was pregnancy outcomes. And it was Marianne, through that meeting, said, oh, you can use my PPP. I'm happy for you to do that. So it's those kind of people that you meet. And if you've been in any sessions that I've moderated today, I've been really saying, please say your name, please say where you're from, because we all need to get to know each other really well. It was also at a similar meeting that I met Dr. Lorraine Bacchus years ago. And again, because of her research at that time, looking at pregnant women, and you were in London at that time.
I was at King's College.
Yeah, you were at King's College, and right, so doing work in, anyway, so this is how it's really impacted the actual organization. Then you've asked me to also talk a little bit about practice. And at the same time, so the reason I didn't get to go to the 1985 and be an inaugural member of NNVAWI is because Dr. Ann Hilton was doing her work at Texas Women's University under Dr. Judy McFarlane. And Anne got to go the first year, and then Judy funded me to go the second year. So unfortunately, I cannot lay the claim to fame, but Anne came back and was raving. And about the same time, and Jackie alluded to that the government didn't really care, but the Surgeon General at that time was C. Everett Koop. C. Everett Koop held a big conference in Dallas, Texas. So Ann Hilton, Judy McFarlane, myself, we were all in Houston. We made ourselves known, and we actually went to the conference, Sue Everett Koop's healthcare conference on, and it was violence and smoking, wasn't it?
I think the first one was, yeah.
Yes, it had something. Anyway, we were there, and then that went on to get C. Everett Koop to introduce the film that Judy McFarlane, Ann Hilton, and myself had a March of Dimes grant. And so that was in 1986. And we produced the training video that really started training healthcare providers to assess for domestic violence. And I think,
he issued that report, the Surgeon General's report on domestic violence and health, maybe? No. Yeah. But it was family violence, because he
That's
included
right.
child abuse.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. And a couple of us got to go to that thing in D.C.
Well, I think the first one was in Dallas.
The first one was Dallas.
Dallas, and then the big one was in D.C. So
we
I think
Texas behind.
which is probably a good thing. Anyway, okay, so Michelle.
All right, so next we're going to hear from Marilyn Ford Gilbo, who is a distinguished university professor and the Women's Health Research Chair in Rural Health at the Arthur Labatt Family School of Nursing at Western University in Ontario, Canada. She's a background in public health, and her research focuses on reducing health inequities among women who have experienced intimate partner violence, particularly those who are in the transition of separation and who face significant barriers to support. This has included studies examining how mothers and children who have separated from an abusive partner promote their health, the long-term health and economic impacts of intimate partner violence for women, how shelters provide support for women who have experienced abuse, and the impacts of innovative healthcare and online interventions on the safety, health, and quality of life of women who've experienced intimate partner violence. So our question for you is to tell us a little bit about a few of the research studies conducted through network collaboration and how these collaborations began.
Okay. I'm not sure I can follow the first two speakers, but I'm going to give it a go. The network has been extremely important in the development of our, and I'll use the word our because it really is our research program, particularly in Canada. So when I'm hearing Jackie say, you know, the network started with seven people, well, the population of the U.S. is 10 times that of Canada. And when I first got involved in or interested in violence research, there were a handful of us in Canada. And interestingly enough, most of us were connected to Jackie Campbell because we had done our PhDs at Wayne State and been introduced to this area. The first of the studies that we did was really that we sought funding for a team grant, national team grant, that was funded then through the precursor to the Canadian Institutes of Health Research. And I went to my very first NMBWI meeting in Vancouver looking for some collaborators. So Judy Wiest and I had already been working together closely on some qualitative work, grounded theory work, looking at the impacts of separation on women and how they navigated that for themselves and their children. But we were going to try to apply for this grant, not sure whether we would get it or not, because we were really early career scholars, pretty barely out of our PhDs, but we thought we'd give it a go. So, in fact, that's where I met Colleen Varco, who's been a longtime colleague of mine for 20-some-odd years, Judy Wiest until she retired, and she actually is still working with Kelly Scott Story, who is our other collaborator in New Brunswick. She comes into the office and works as her research assistant, believe it or not. That's her emeritus position. Yes, it's true. And, over the years, like I said, it's been a 20-year collaboration that started with that very first proposal. And Jackie was there as a consultant on that first project to help us get going, which we sorely appreciated, because we were really also carving new territory. There had been very few studies funded nationally in Canada looking at violence and health, and we were able to look at the long-term health consequences of some of these experiences of trauma and violence for women after separation from an abusive partner, which was a bit of a niche focus. Since then, we've done lots of studies. Moving to intervention studies, mostly more recently with the iHeal intervention, which is a nurse-led, trauma and violence-informed approach to working with women in a relational model that has taken 10 years and many pilot studies, including studies with Indigenous women, a particular version called Reclaiming Our Spirits that Colleen was the lead on, and a trial that we just finished that I'm going to be talking about on Thursday, and some wonderful opportunities that came through the network through a collaboration with Nancy. I see Nancy Glass back there in the corner. I think that might have been a meeting in a bar in New Zealand. Was it a bar? Australia or New Zealand? Which was it? Australia, New Zealand. And a collaboration that started testing online interventions through, you know, really Nancy approaching myself and Jane Cozio-McLean and Kelsey Hegarty to see if we were interested in taking this very cool and creative ideas she had and adapting it and testing it in trials in her own countries. And that, I think, really developed into a really productive partnership that has led now to each of those teams going off on their own and developing country-specific public versions of apps that are either rolled out or getting ready to roll out. And, you know, it's through the generosity of inviting people into partnership, I think that is what the key has been. So lots of good things going on, and so many graduate students that we have supported to come to this meeting over the many years. I know this is true of everybody here. And what a difference it's made, because by exposure to some of this work, some have gone off to do their own careers, develop their own careers in violence research, but many of them are doing research in other areas, always mindful of how violence figures in. And in some ways, that's, you know, sort of the unspoken or really impactful piece as well, because it's creating some infiltration of these ideas into many areas of practice and research.
Yeah, so. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Next, we're going to hear from Jocelyn Anderson, who is an assistant professor at the Pennsylvania State University College of Nursing. She is an internationally certified sexual assault nurse examiner, providing medical forensic care for patients who have experienced physical or sexual violence. And her research has focused on the physical and mental health outcomes of violence and interventions to prevent and respond to violence. She is particularly interested in using technology-based interventions to improve health and justice outcomes at the intersections of violence, substance use, and mental health issues. So, Jocelyn, our question for you is to tell us a little bit about how joining NNVAWI as a student and early career researcher has helped you to create new collaborations. You just presented on some of this work, but how you've used that to grow and change kind of over the years.
Yeah, so I'll start, I think, with my very first NNVAWI story, because that's how did I get here? So as I think with many people in this room, it started as being a graduate student. And I was at the time in Baltimore at Hopkins with Jackie and Nancy and Dan Sheridan, who was also mentioned. And I was in my very first year of a PhD program. I had just finished the master's program working with Dan in that forensic nursing program and had done a systematic review during that master's program. And Dan had sent me an email saying, by the way, I submitted that review to NNVAWI and I put your name on it to present it. And so that was, I was voluntold that I was going to this conference. And I was going to be presenting, and I, as someone who doesn't love public speaking, was absolutely terrified. And my first NNVAWI was in Charlottesville, Virginia. So drove down to Charlottesville and had my very first professional research conference ever. And I will forever remember Susan Jack sitting in the back row, who was also in my session, nodding so kindly to get me through that very first presentation ever. That is the family that this group becomes, that I will forever remember, the face in the back of the room who helped me get through that very first presentation ever. And you know, now I am a decade later after that first NNVAWI, and through the years have come back to every single one that has happened in the interim, because this became my research family. And so my question that I'm supposed to be answering is to talk about those collaborations and how that has helped my, you know, research career. And so for folks who weren't in the last session and didn't just get to hear me talk about this paper about NIH funding that we wrote, Jessica Williams, who you have all heard talk about this conference and have gotten lots of emails from, as well as two other colleagues who aren't able to be here but who are network members and have been here before, Candace Burton and Jessica Dron Moret, it was the last conference then, because the interim got canceled. So in Niagara, we were having a conversation about, you know, how do we kind of build some of these collaborations. We've seen the collaboration that Marilyn and Nancy and Kelsey Hegarty have had around working together to share and build on this work of the My Plan app and collaborate across the globe on that project. I've seen, you know, Jackie's CV many times and seen those same names of Jackie and Linda, you know, back in the day, you know, working together on publications and had some conversations at a bar about how did that come to be? And got to hear some lovely conversation about, you know, working together to, you know, partner on papers. If somebody had a data set, how do we set up a way to share that data and work together to get that next publication out and to cheerlead for each other and to set up those mechanisms that work? And so we kind of all went back to our homes and were like, you know, we were all assistant professors in our respective homes and said, you know, this is something that I think would be really helpful for us, as we were all kind of the only violence researcher in our individual homes, and saying, how do we keep doing this on the day-to-day without that, without our violence family here with us? And so since that time, we've been able to kind of establish some routines using our internet around, using Zoom before Zoom was the only way to communicate, using Google Docs to create shared documents and work on things. I hear back in the day they had to like travel to actually be together to work on papers together, which probably was more fun. Writing in person is good times. So we've been able to have both a really fun and a really productive work environment, and I think so. There's both it's been a really productive. We've been able to write papers. We've been able to write some grants together that have, hopefully one is about to be successful. And we've also then, I think it's been really positively rewarding and fun as far as having that group of people that you know you've got on your calendar to check in with regularly, who get what you do and who, you know, I've got some other great colleagues in my institution who may get research or may get the local politics of what's going on, but they don't necessarily understand some of the, you know, what violence research looks like and what some of those intricacies look like. And so being able to have that group of people to have those conversations with and to have that safe space has just been a really rewarding group to work with.
Thank you, Jocelyn. So I'm going to introduce our next two speakers together, and they have a couple of slides they're going to share as well. So first is Lorraine Backus, who is an associate professor of social science at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Her research focuses on the development and evaluation of complex interventions within health systems and services that address violence against women and against men in same-sex relationships. Her research spans high-income and low- and middle-income countries and is based in primary healthcare and sexual and reproductive healthcare settings. In particular, she is interested in questions about the transferability of those interventions to different settings, how context shapes intervention fidelity, and the kinds of adaptive practices that emerge from this. Manuela Colombini is an associate professor in health systems and policy and gender-based violence in the Department of Global Health and Development. She has conducted research in gender-based violence, integration of HIV and sexual and reproductive health services in sub-Saharan Africa and Asia for the past 18 years. Her research has primarily focused on exploring how health system factors affect development and integration of health interventions for vulnerable women and girls. She has also conducted formative and evaluation research to explore new intervention approaches to address violence against women in the health sector, and translating evidence on health system strengthening from promising interventions within low and middle income settings. So our question for both of you, what we've asked you to talk a little bit more about is to tell us about your work building collaborations in low and middle income settings. How do you think NNVAWI can continue to help facilitate and build global partnerships to advance research, practice, and education related to violence against women?
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you for inviting us to this panel as well. So we want to present our experiences of developing a global health collaboration on violence against women. And this is a collaboration that spans 6 years. It's named Hera after the Greek goddess. So that stands for healthcare responding to violence and abuse. And we thought there'd be a little group of us here today, but sadly our Sri Lankan partners couldn't make it because of visa issues, although Claudia Garcia Moreno, who's also working on this collaboration, has joined us, so there is a little group of us. And so Hera actually is about strengthening the healthcare response to violence against women, focusing on intimate partner violence and other kind of forms of domestic violence in the home. And our partners are from Sri Lanka, Palestine, Brazil, and Nepal. And so we've just been kind of thinking through some of the key principles around the partnership and what has made it successful and some of our learnings from it as well. And I think a key thing in terms of the partners that we work with is that they all have very strong links with stakeholders in their countries, and particularly ministries of health, municipal level health officials, women's NGOs, community groups, women's groups. And that's really important in terms of the creation of the ideas comes from them. It comes from the local context. It means that the research and the interventions are really aligned already with what they're doing in terms of developing violence against women policy and programs. And it means that there's more uptake of these interventions after the pilot studies. So, for example, we know in Brazil, Professor Ana Flavia de Oliveira, who is the principal investigator there at the University of Sao Paulo, her training has been extended beyond the study site. So other regions in Brazil have asked her to implement that training. Similarly, in Nepal, the PI there, Poonam Rishal, Kathmandu University, they've been asked to also disseminate their training as well. Secondly, was embedding a multi-directional research capacity strengthening program. And I think for the last sort of decade or so, I think this is now a requirement for any collaboration with research collaboration with low and middle income country partners, that there must be a research capacity strengthening program in there. But this isn't a kind of north to south endeavor. This is really multi-directional. It's north to south, it's south to north, it's south to south. And the leadership of that is really between partners from the UK, which would be the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine and the University of Bristol, I forgot to say, but also our ELMIC partners in Sri Lanka, University of Peradeniya, and University of Sao Paulo also lead that program. Our group had ran a kind of exercise together at one of our international workshops where we tried to come to some consensus on the values that we wanted to use to guide our group, the way we work together. And so some of those are there: transparency, mutual learning, fairness of opportunity. And that's kind of really important, not just in research capacity strengthening, but in the way we work day to day and communicate. And so we have evaluated that program, and it's kind of action oriented. So we engage in reflection on that, and we adapt according to what we found. And that really helps to kind of strengthen institutional structures so that the partnership benefits are sustained. Partners want to develop their own kind of hubs at their universities or even regional hubs on research on violence against women and health. it benefits in terms of the mutual learning and the knowledge sharing that we engage in. It helps to sustain and support the early career researchers so that we retain them in academia and they're not lost. And also sharing of our research networks. So all the universities have research networks that we've been able to collaborate with. And I'll hand over to Manuela.
Okay. Thank you, Lorraine. So I'm here to then kind of focus on the last two points. So the kind of other critical element that we identify is really building trust. So among all the collaborators, and how do we do that? And how do one do that? Because I think this is really a critical element in kind of long-term research partnerships, so to trust each other because we use data, we collect data, and in the analysis. So, and we did that through a lot of regular meetings. So we had our monthly calls for the past probably 4 or 5 years in and out all the time to catch up with the, not just the kind of data collection, but also any challenges that then we would try and solve as a group. And very interesting also, we had a very non-hierarchical approach. So it wasn't very much at all a kind of a top-down with only PIs meeting, but it was very inclusive. So also the very junior researcher and early career would participate in these meetings so that they could also be exposed to this kind of decision-making and then kind of also being question and ask to participate and actually give their opinion about some of the challenges they were experiencing. So I think that was kind of really important to promote more kind of equitable relationship across all the different countries. And I think also impacted on some of the kind of less, I would say, senior local PIs as well, that also gain a lot of kind of independence and experience in doing that. And we had a lot of discussions, and I think that's also very important. So open discussion, and sometimes it was not always easy. So we learn a lot about having early on in our kind of defining the collaborations. So it's not just about the developing the protocols, but it's also thinking about the roles of each of the partners, and also thinking about publications very early on, because you assume that, well, we will have a lot of first authors publication, the same with the countries, but actually then who will really benefit from this? And also data sharing, which was really important as well. And we had open discussion and difficult as well to understand and how to build trust also with our local colleagues, that we would not just take the data because it was it resided in Bristol according to the grant, but then that the data was actually owned by the countries and they could actually use it and they would share it with us if they wanted, so it wasn't the other way around. So, and that was also very important to have these discussions openly so that nothing was left assumed and really kind of not discussed. And really, this enabled joint analysis as well, so that we were not just each country did the analysis by themselves, but it was really a lot of dialogue and discussions, and especially when we were trying to do kind of synthesis across the countries as well. And it sparked also a lot of kind of knowledge kind of hub and sharing, not just across the kind of global north and global south, but it also the other way around. And also between countries as well, where actually a lot of the Brazilian colleagues then wanted to talk and then discuss with the Nepal colleagues to think about maybe possible collaboration, and also a lot of commonalities and differences across their data settings. So which was very interesting. And the other kind of benefit of this kind of building trust and communication, it was also having more collaborative disseminations as well. So that, again, not all the opportunities were left to a more senior researcher, but also early careers could also go and present, for example, in conferences as well. And so that's where NAVI was actually quite important for us, because we have at least, I think, two of our researchers that are presenting virtually here at the conference. The last point that I wanted to make, it's also about being aware of the different differences in academic culture. So it's not just knowing the research context in the setting, but also being aware of the different cultures in academia. And even just between, I don't know, the Bristol and the LSHTM, there were kind of very different kind of, I don't know, shared values. And it was important to really understand also the kind of values and the culture in our, in the academic institutions of the local partners as well, because it was very different. And it was really try to then discuss and see how we could all accommodate and work together through our discussion of the kind of shared values, especially in terms of mutual learning. And so this was really part of our key principle of co-production as well, so that it was, we were all equal partners together, despite the funding were coming from Bristol and NSHTM, but we were all kind of working at the same level. And this is really to promote a more kind of equitable relationship. And also enable a lot of more opportunities also for the young researchers, especially in some of the settings where actually there was this kind of tacit rule where only the local PI would be first author on all the publication, for example, where the young researcher would be left with, I mean, yeah, just a name on a long list of authorship, but then we were able to really have those discussions and really make sure that each young researcher would then also have a first authorship paper as well as a kind of an outcome. So, and that was for our kind of example from the era, but we had, I think, another part of our question.
The next slide, please. Next slide, please.
And how can NAVI facilitate and build a partnership? So, and this is particularly with the ELMI countries. And I feel a bit, how would I say, not ashamed, but it's like I'm not from an ELMI countries, but I can kind of, I don't know. I don't know if I can talk on behalf of my colleagues, but I will try. And I think that for us, I mean, for them going to and disseminate their work to international conference like this one is really important, because I think a lot of their work probably sometimes stays unknown. Unless you really know their research partners. So I think it's really important to advertise the conference. And then maybe one thing, I kind of put like advertise a NAVI membership to researchers also from the ELMIC and maybe opening to our partners, because there are great partners out there that would really benefit. And maybe to kind of thinking about now with this whole movement of decolonizing global health and right, and kind of switching kind of the way we see things and the kind of power imbalances, and maybe think it's like how the ELMIC researchers can actually help NAVI to really then produce research and continue to kind of lead the field in the violence against women. So I think that was probably a question that maybe NAVI could be the pioneer and really start a dialogue for that. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So we have a bit more time now, and we wanted to open it up and see if there are any questions from the audience. We have a great panel up here with a lot of expertise related to violence against women, research, practice, and policy, as well as NAVAWI, if you're wanting to learn a little more about the history. So I'm going to go ahead and come around in case there are any questions. I think there's one more microphone here. So any questions at all? Here you go, Jessica.
So, to me, one of the challenging things always with collaborations is and networking is finding something that is meaningful enough to be kind of worth everybody's time who's committing to it, but then also making it feasible as well, particularly when you're starting out. I think there's so many times where, you know, I'll meet somebody, you know, wherever at a conference or whatnot, and we talk about, you know, oh, well, we should find something to work together. Oh, I'd love to work with you. I'd love to work with you. You know, and that always happens. But then, you know, it's sort of like that. I feel like until you get that initial step, you know, it can be very difficult to start that. And so I was just wondering if any of you had any advice for how to sort of create boundaries or a structure or a goal or something like that that you've found useful in starting particularly new collaborations.
Get your story straight.
I think you just need to click it up.
Yeah. There it is. Okay. One of the things that I think, for me, is incredibly important is that I have to really genuinely like the people that I am going to commit to spend a lot of time with, a lot of, and I have found that most people that stick with this hard stuff, I do tend to like, because they clearly have some altruistic stuff going on, and they truly care about women's health, decreasing violence against people, children and men also, but you know, we do have this a little bit of a feminist stuff going on somewhere. Never forget, my daughter used to just cringe whenever I said anything about feminism. And she's come around now, you know, at 50, you know, she's come around. But it's come back in style. But I think that's really important, that shared values, but also really liking to spend time with them. And part of that is forgiving each other. All right, so somebody's coming up on a hard patch for whatever, family, whatever, and they miss a deadline. Yes, as a group, we make these deadlines, these internal deadlines, and we try and hold each other to them, but we also forgive if somebody just can't, and that somebody else is willing to pick up the weight, because you have spent time with each other, you know, over breakfast, and I know talk a lot at the bar, but we've spent actual fun time with each other, and that's one thing, you know, many of us try to build into our times at NBAWI is some fun time or exercise time or, you know, something like that, so that you see each other outside of the academic settings. I think all of those things are incredibly important, and I do think, though, that the publication piece, most of us are in either academia or some place where publications are they count. They're the coin of the realm. I think I've said that to a couple of PhD students. and so that making sure that you have those publications at different places, and I love all of that kind of thing, but also that the, you know, when you're planning a publication, okay, who needs to be first author? Not who deserves it to be first author, but who needs it? Who needs it the most? Okay, are you willing to do that first draft? Then, okay, you got it. You know, that's the kind of thing, and in planning publications going forward, that sort of spirit, I think, is just incredibly important. And we all gain from that.
Can I add something to that? Yeah, I think there is something about the messages that we get about how you create teams that we have to resist sometimes. And knowing that not everybody on a team is going to be able to contribute equally, that I think in the spirit of this conference, we should be thinking about equity. So what is feasible for people based on how they're positioned? You know, if you have members on your team who have more release time from teaching, it makes sense that maybe they take on a heavier load on some of the administrative reporting, all of that stuff that we don't like to do, but somebody has to do it. And that, to make it possible for a colleague who has a heavy teaching load, you know, to really be able to contribute meaningfully to a project, but in a way that's going to work for them. So I think, you know, that spirit of equity rather than thinking about equal contribution is something that can go a long way in sustaining a team over time.
Yeah, so I would say kind of trying not to repeat things that have already been said, but that are somewhat similar. So I think one of the things that has been super helpful in many of the collaborations that I have built, particularly out of folks in this room, is to start by assuming good intent, with folks, and that so that includes that being very forgiving, as well as then like having open and transparent conversations about what does people's workload look like, what are feasible deadlines, do those deadlines need to change, and then from a very, very kind of practical standpoint, from like how did we do some of those very first things. Like, we also started with something that it was still working towards that goal of that currency, that publication being we were all in that assistant professor, like that was what we all needed on our CVs at the time. But starting with something that otherwise felt kind of like a low-hanging, so it was a non-data-based publication. We didn't have to deal with any who's sharing data, whose data is this. It was a publication looking at trauma-informed nursing education and the nursing essentials. So something that we all had been working on in our own worlds, that we all had knowledge and expertise on, and we could all kind of take pieces of and work on this publication as we were building those relationships. And you know, once we had that, it was easier to work into sharing data and working on grants and working on things that had more complex moving parts. But starting with something that felt a little less overwhelming, I think worked really well for us to be able to feel those things out and to build that trust as we were building those relationships in a partnership.
Yeah. And one thing just to follow up on the publication, because I think I miss a very important point, and I think in any collaboration with ELMIC countries, it's also the issue of the language, which we take for granted, of course, and being non-native English speaker, I tell you, it's really hard. And especially when you have to always write, and like there is always a much better way of telling things, and when you work with a lot of your ELMIC countries, it's not easy. So we had to even offer English classes, and we do writing workshops. So I think this is something to really consider in terms of kind of collaboration with ELMIC, and even attend us at conferences, because not many are fluent or very fluent in English. So even just to be able to present, it's a big achievement. So I think it's something that probably to also think about for the kind of NAVI. In terms of, I don't know, ideas or suggestions of how to build collaboration, I always think about if there is an interesting funding opportunity that I maybe see, and then I think, oh, actually, I met so-and-so at the conference, or, oh, I know that we could do something on this topic, so it's something that could be possible. I think we always say with Susan how many times we said, oh, we should do something together, and we nearly had the opportunity, so we're getting there, so slowly, slowly.
I was going to say, linked to the publications is where you publish as well. So obviously there's a lot of pressure to publish in international journals, and that's quite hard for early career researchers whose English is limited. But some of our partners are publishing in local journals, so in their local languages, because that's who they want to influence as well. So they're doing both international journals and local journals. I agree with everything. It's about liking people. I really agree with that a lot. It's about your reputation in the field. Is someone collegial? You know, it's a lot about, oh, you should work with so-and-so. She's really nice. You hear that all the time. She's really good to work with. And I think that's how I ended up working with Linda, because my first, I joined in 2004 when you had your conference on the back of the Futures Without Violence. And I was presenting my PhD and my postdoctoral work, and that's when I first met Jackie and Linda, and it was so overwhelming. But we kept saying we should do something together, and I did end up doing some research with Linda through this Marie Curie Fellowship. So it is a lot about networking and kind of, yeah, there's a lot of, you know, friendships emerge out of this, lifelong friendships as well. I just wanted to add that.
I have an add-on to that really quick. So thinking about funding, I think is challenging. We just heard a little about this in one of the sessions, and you know, violence funding isn't easy to find. And so if you could speak a little bit about funding mechanisms, especially for those international partnerships, and how you've navigated that and stayed afloat in those collaborations.
Lorraine, why don't you use Lorraine?
Yeah, I guess, I can say a little bit about
the HERA project, because, you know, a lot of the funding, it still really comes from the global north. And so then, and actually, things have changed. So the funding comes from the global north, and it's usually held at a global north institution. Now, a lot of funding streams in the UK are National Institute for Health Research, I think MRC, Medical Research Council. The lead, the host institution, can now be a partner from a low and middle income country. It doesn't need to be, for example, the UK, or they now do joint leads as well. So that's changing. I think with Marie Curie, that was a really a big call, really, for researchers, mid-career researchers in Europe who wanted to work outside of Europe. And, you know, who did I know? Well, I mostly knew people from the nursing network. So that's how that came about. And yes, and of course, you know, you were doing research on violence in pregnancy. I was doing that as well. And so there was that link. So
if we hadn't had nursing network,
no, we wouldn't. We wouldn't know. I wouldn't have done the fellowship. Yeah. So, and I think with the whole international thing, you know, how can we advertise and make it bigger? You know, it's word of mouth, because I think when I came, I might have been one of two people from the UK, but now there are more UK people, and you know, it's through spreading the word. So, yeah, but that's just sort of going back to how to, you know, make it wider and inclusive.
Yeah, and I really think a couple of things. First of all, there's a lot of fellowships for junior researchers and those kinds of things. And you have to search a lot of times, and foundations change their priorities, and they're notorious for revitalizing or revamping or whatever they do. But foundations can be extremely important to cultivate. And over time, and to see, you know, the big grants and grants for junior people, but that's the kind of thing that you can use to actually be the foundation of some of these international collaborations. Fulbright's, for instance, can be incredibly valuable. But the other thing is to be creative in what you're thinking about, strategic and creative around that. And of course, with the foundations, oftentimes you cultivate a relationship with a foundation director or a program officer at a foundation. So over time, you can think of different ways to go at it. One of my first big grants was with the Department of Defense, for crying out loud. And what I did was they were feeling guilty because they hadn't funded any women's health research at all. Not much. Anyway, so I applied to do a study of domestic violence in active duty military women compared to civilian women and health outcomes. So it's, you know, it's sort of like, you know, think, okay, there's this RFA that comes out, how can I make it support what I want to do? Even though, what did I know about active duty military women? Nothing. But I got some collaborators that knew more about that. It was one of the first things that Phyllis Sharps and I collaborated on. So, you know, those are the kinds of things, and then to try and put supplements on it. So you say to funder A, so we got some money to do this, so you could give some. You wouldn't have to do the whole ball game. You can just do a little bit to help us spread it to another country, to bring in another angle on, like, abuse during pregnancy, so kids grow up, right? So those are the kinds of things that you have to kind of think broadly. And I do think brainstorming sessions around that are really useful. And I think in terms of the practicalities, once you get together once, you know, the old, we should do something together around X, Y, or Z. So then make an appointment for a follow-up phone call or something right then, or else it'll get lost in the everything everybody has to do.
I want to tag on, in, I don't think it's been said yet, but the way when we started, we would have stayed a couple of extra days after this.
Yeah.
And we would have tried to find cheap lodging, cheap, you know, we've done some really crazy things to be able to stay over. But, and then that way you can have intense work and that getting to know each other, what you were saying, learn to trust. I remember as just a junior person, you know, being around all these senior people who had their PhDs, we went around and we did check-in, remember, every time we got together. So we all know each other's history. I mean, it's like Jackie's my sister because I know everything about her family. She knows everything about my family. And I think that's really, really important. So try to, you know, if you know somebody you want to collaborate with, we're going to be together here at this meeting. Let's take an extra day or so and do that brainstorming. Write that publication together.
Thank you. I think I was saying somebody had their hand up.
Hello. Hey, my name is Qing Li. I'm a first-time attendee of this conference. My question relates to how this organization has been engaging and nurture the interest in accessing the hard-to-reach countries in the world, such as, I'm so lucky today I met three from Thailand. There are several from China. Maybe there are several from South Africa. It's, in my presentation, I heard so difficult to study those issues in those regions, countries. How the history in BAWI has been really nurturing those interests in those countries.
I can maybe start with this, although I'm not, I don't sit on the board anymore, but I was on the board for quite a long while. And I think this issue of extending beyond the original I, Linda, you know, the interest.
We had to have one international person to be able to put international in it. And it really, after that, is when we came to Australia, New Zealand.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. I think this idea of trying to extend the network, though, to really be a global network has been a priority on the agenda for at least 10 years. It's probably longer than that. And I don't think there's any one thing, but I wanted to commend the current board for the efforts they've been making, because I can see that in the last couple of years, there's been a more really proactive approach to trying to keep people engaged in online discussion forums to bring students together. I heard there was a wonderful, successful student session a few weeks back that brought students together from all over the place. And it really is the nurturing of those relationships. And truthfully, as much as this conference, perhaps the hybrid format is more or less due to COVID. And it has been difficult to organize. I heard Jessica say that. There also are these benefits in terms of the ability of people to participate who would never have been able to come to the conference. And, you know, I think that openness to really try to do the harder thing is a great thing. So I would love to have a round of applause for the current board, because I think they're doing wonderful work.
I think we have time for one more question. Yes.
Hi, my name is Nick Matheny. I'm a first-time attendee, early career researcher. But I wanted to ask, as Donna's new subordinate on the Finance Committee, There are a lot of sort of these international organizations. It's fine. A lot of international organizations, I think of SVRI as one that has sort of broken into the grant-making space itself to sort of plug some of the holes that you all were talking about in the funding mechanisms. And I'm wondering, is that something that you think from your long expertise in this organization that should be in our lane? And if it is, if there's a specific area of research or a specific type of researcher that you would advocate for starting this grant-making process if the funds were available?
Yeah, seriously, senior. You know, I don't know. I know that SVRI, and we ought to, somebody that's on the board, maybe ought to take a close look at how they've gone there and pros and cons of that approach. We've always been sort of mindful of each other's bandwidth on something like that, and it's you know, it takes a lot of work, and whether or not that actually, I'm always mindful about what people need in order to succeed at what they're doing in their career, and something like that can sometimes not benefit the people that have put a whole lot of time into it. It benefits the organization. Bravo, that'd be wonderful. But I don't know. You know, that's something we could think about, for heaven's sakes. And we had a big discussion at one point, to get rid of the nursing focus, and we decided not to. But that doesn't mean in 10 years, you know, over my dead body. No, not really. that the rest of the organization might decide to do that. And so, you know, that's the kind of thing. I mean, we've always had a place in the world, and maybe that's just real parochial in terms of, you know, and maybe that would be a way that we really could expand to low and middle income countries. When you think about how much nursing is the rock, the what public health in the global sense is built on, and how many incredibly talented, amazing nurses there are out there, and that maybe, you know, we really could do more of what you guys are doing, for instance, and what the Norwegian group is doing. Maybe that is possible. So, you know, I'm like, those of you that are come up, go for it. But, you know, I don't know. It's tough. It's really tough, and it's really expensive. And as much as we like the virtual kind of possibilities, it's still not. I mean, collaborators that I have never sat with that have only been on Zoom, you know, I don't have that affinity that we've talked about being really helpful. But we certainly like it. At Hopkins, we have a bunch of international PhD students that we certainly could do more about bringing into the fold.
So. All right. Let's give a round of applause to our amazing panel here today.
And I have one other thing to say. You know, that textbook, that Family Violence and Nursing Practice, we do have a plan for another edition. And if anybody wants to be part of it, most of your mentors say don't ever do a textbook chapter. However, this is an exception because it's for nursing. And nursing students are still using textbooks. I know we think that's, gone the way of the dinosaur, but they still are buying textbooks. So if we made it popular and wonderful, maybe we would get more of our nursing students to learn better and more about family violence and violence against women.
So thank you again to our panel. This was an excellent way to close out the day. And in the true spirit of collaboration and making new collaborations, we're going to move into a reception. And so I get the honor of telling everybody you have a free drink ticket in the back of your name tag. And the reception will be in this room. So in the back, as we've been talking, they've set up a bar and some hors d'oeuvres over on the right-hand side. And for the next hour and a half, the goal is to enjoy each other's company and form some new collaborations. Thank you all for joining.
Oh, thank you, Michelle.